Hey guys, I'm Chris. Thank you guys so much for coming. Special thanks to Zach and Elaine for helping put this together. So I really appreciate you guys for all coming out. So just to let you guys know, this mic is actually just for recording the talk because a lot of students can't come. It's not supposed to make me louder or anything, so it's probably funny. I wanted to come to CMU because I was a bit of an oddball. I really liked drawing and stuff, and I just kind of wanted to come back and share my experience with you guys. The first part will just be some storytelling. The storytelling part really isn't that educational, but I find them highly entertaining when I go to conferences and talks. I love the storytelling part. Then I'm gonna go into finding a job, and then I'm gonna go into the tutorial, which probably most of you guys will want to see. And yeah, let's get started. But first, I took the survey already. So School of Art and Design, raise your hand. Yeah, right? Let's see, and we have an engineer, we have some theater and ETC, right? And then mostly, do we have any design professionals in here or mostly students? We have one grad student, right? Okay, cool. All right. Well, let's just get started. Is there anyone in here who wants to be a concept artist by any chance? Two people? What major are you guys?
Entertainment tech.
Entertainment tech? Okay, cool. And you?
Art.
Art? Okay, what's entertainment tech? Is that drama?
ETC?
Okay, cool. So two. And then for you, Adela, kind of maybe, right? Maybe? Okay, cool. All right. Why are most of you guys here? Do you guys just like art and stuff? I know I like tried to solicit and get you guys to come here, but why are you guys here? What do you guys want to find out or learn?
I really like
concept art. Concept art? Okay. Do you guys, most of you guys like concept art and stuff? Okay, cool. Sounds good. All right. I wanted to ask, I forgot. Just wanted to ask, any people do LG here? LG people, Lunar Gala, cool. Any Spring Carnival Boost people? Any Boost? No, Greeks? Any Greeks in here?
I'm Russian.
Russian? Oh no, I mean like Kappa Phi Theta.
No, I mean like I'm Russian.
Oh, you're Russian. Oh, I thought you said you're Russian. I'm like, pretty crushed. Cool. Well, good luck. Okay, cool. Well, this is my 2-minute elevator pitch. It's like a good intro video.
Hi, my name is Chris Chien, and this is my 2-minute elevator pitch. I'm an illustrator working for theme parks. In my past, I've also done stuff for video games, some live action movies. I want to talk about what makes me different. As an illustrator, I understand how important it is to be a part of the team. As someone who's actually built stuff with my hands, when I'm creating illustrations, I'm also thinking about how much it is gonna cost, how are you going to build it, how do you tear it down. So essentially, I'm really concerned about the entire project, not just the blue sky phase, but everything from its conception to its production and to its operations. In the past, I've done a lot of trade show booths, carnival booths, done a lot of projects where I worked on it from the beginning sketches to the finished product. What I'm really passionate about is working a part of a team together. I think that's one of the most exciting parts of a project. When people of different backgrounds come together and work together, I think that's so fulfilling. Secondly, building better businesses. Besides my freelance consultancy, I sell my artwork at conventions, I go to birthday parties, and I have an online store. And I understand how business really affects the design of a product. Lastly, I think really great work starts with a really strong purpose. I have this dream, build a better world. Use my skills to better the lives of other people. Just last year, in January 2014, I went to Guatemala and painted a mural at an orphanage. It was a really fulfilling experience. Not just to see the happiness in the kids' eyes, but to know that I'm able to use my professional skills in a really meaningful way I hope I'm able to use these skills to better the lives of other people, of my friends, my family, and people all over the world. Okay, that about sums it up. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. Thank you. Bye-bye.
I want to tell you guys my background story and stuff. Typically, when I go to these talks and stuff, it usually goes like, I grew up not knowing art. Maybe they were poor, or people told them they were going to fail, and then they worked really hard and became successful and stuff like that. And the lesson is like, do what you love, believe in yourself, and follow your dreams. My story was a little bit different. It's a little bit unusual. As an artist, I didn't get bad grades like most artists do. I actually got good grades. So whenever I go to talks, I kind of feel weird. But if you're here at CMU, you might be kind of like me, which is why I wanted to mention that, because you do need good grades to get into CMU. And you also, you know, if you're in art or design, you have to be good at that too. So it's like it's an interesting, you know, but different thing. So basically, my story was I got good grades, but I wanted to do art not because I loved it, not because it was my life. It was because I felt like I could get like the number one in art. Like, I wasn't the smartest. Like, I'd maybe get like 92% on a math test, but like three other kids would get 95, 97, and 100%. And I'm like, yo, I can't beat these kids. You know, like, they're too smart. You know, those kids are like the kind of kids who go to like Stanford and Yale and like Harvard and stuff. You know, I wasn't that smart. But I was really competitive. You know, I wanted to get good, so I chose art because I thought maybe I could be number one if I did art, because they're not doing art. Okay. So early on, as you can tell, I was kind of competitive. That's why I chose art, and I also did a lot of art competitions. I started at a really young age, age 6, taking art classes, and I competed a lot. I started from like Christmas card competitions, small stuff, and eventually I won bigger stuff. First place, second place. I'd get pissed if I got a second place award. That's how competitive it was for me. Well, you know, it's like growing up in a household, if you get like a B+ or like a 98, it's like, oh my God, you know, like, got a B. Or, no? You guys, right?
Yeah.
Yeah? Or, I don't know if you guys seen like the meme where it's like, you get 98% on the test, and then the dad is like, where'd the other 2% go? No? Okay, maybe you guys, your parents were cooler than mine. Yeah? Okay, cool. Okay. Well, this talk probably won't resonate with all of you guys, but it might resonate with a few. And I guess that's what I really want. Okay, so I do want to talk about why I'm so into like business and marketing and stuff. When I made this talk, I wasn't asked to come here as a guest. I emailed Zach and emailed Elaine, and I was like, hey, can I do this talk? You know, I volunteered myself. And I'm really about putting myself out there. And one of the reasons is because when I was maybe around 10 years old, my art teacher shut down his art studio because he couldn't pay the bills and cover the rent. It was something like he couldn't keep track of his students giving money or something like that. And he was bad at accounting, and his wife recently had a baby, and basically he had no money. So he had to close it down. And from that moment, I was like, okay, I'm not just gonna get good at art, I'm gonna get good at math, accounting, and business. And that was like a inciting incident at a really early age. Another inciting incident was when I was in sixth grade, right? And the principal of my school at an assembly was like, we're gonna have this art student who's really good design the back cover of the yearbook. And like, I was actually pretty jealous because I felt like, well, you know, like, I'm just as good as this student, but how come the principal didn't pick me? You know, as you can tell, I was really competitive. And what I learned was like, the principal didn't pick me because she didn't know who I was. So that's one of the reasons why I'm really loud, you know? Like, if I want something, I'll be loud and I'll try to go for it. I'll let people know. And it's okay if I fail, but as long as I tried, you know, I at least put my hand up. And if a teacher didn't pick me, or if you didn't, you know, win, it's okay, but it was really important that at least I tried. So yeah. Oh, and the other thing was making a viable living in art and design. That was something my parents were really concerned about. Are your parents concerned? Raise your hand if you have the same, making a living. It's kind of, yeah. My dad was an engineer. He was a computer engineer. My mom was an accountant. So as you can see, my mom works with money and my dad, he's like a computer engineer. So it's like really like, you know, by the book, right? And they're like, are you sure you want to do art? We want to support you. And I tried to prove to them that it was a viable career by winning a bunch of art contests, you know, kind of like overcompensating. So let me see. So since, oops, cool. Oh, well. Here we go. Oh, it's kind of blurry. Jeez. Here we go. Cool, you can see this. So these were like the art contests and art competitions that I entered ever since, and like stuff I won. I wanted to prove that maybe if I win enough money from art competitions, I can prove to them that it's a viable career. And like ever since I was little, like these are like the list of art competitions that I won. So it was like having a chip on your shoulder, you know, like people say you can't do it. And I wanted to prove to them that I could. In the end, they were kind of right, because I couldn't do it. But in the end, I guess in the end, I got back up on my feet. And I'll tell you guys why later. I wanted to say that during high school, there were probably like the toughest years of my life. And it was a little bit different from other people, I guess. I don't know, were your high school years kind of tough? No? Yeah? Okay, so my high school years were kind of tough. I can't speak for everyone. It was because, you know, I was doing like I was trying to get into Carnegie Mellon, right? We're here. So AP courses, right? You have to do community service. You got to learn a second language. So I learned Chinese. Start your own club. I did community service leadership. I started my own art club. Did sports, track and field, right? Because you have to have sports to get into these kind of schools. I was doing a portfolio, and I'll show you guys what my high school work looked like. So this is my high school work. And maybe you guys can like draw like this. Maybe some of you guys are like, yeah, I can do that too. Maybe some of you guys are like, this is pretty good. But I do know like there are some people who can draw like this. And these were a lot of pieces I entered for art competitions. Some won, some didn't. So at that time, I was taking classes at Art Center College of Design, the Saturday High program. And like I was really interested in drawing cars and stuff, which is why I went to industrial design when I went to CMU. Car renderings. This was the class that I took. It was like ID, but in high school. It was really cool. This was like designing a video game design. This was like a vehicle thing, another vehicle thing. But yeah, I was doing this stuff in high school, and I think. And we were building models and stuff too. And I'll show you a bit like my teacher and stuff. So it was hard because my weekends were harder than my weekdays. And at that time I worked like 14 to 20 hours a week. I mean, 14 to 20 hours a day. You know, I would sleep at 11, wake up at 3, and have school the entire freaking day. And my weekends were even harder because I was doing like community service, Chinese school, and SAT prep, and art center. And so my weekends were harder than my weekdays, and my summers were harder than my school year because I was doing SAT boot camp for like 14 hours a day. So I'll talk about this later because I'm gonna talk about lifestyle design. A lot of people know how to work hard in this room, I assume, right? Who knows how to work hard, right? Right? Everyone here knows how to, no, kind of? Okay, because most talks that I've seen, I go to a lot of these talks, right? The art guy is like, the lesson here is to work really hard, you know, and just work 14 to 20 hours a day. But I want to kind of assume that I'm in a room with people who already know how to work hard. You know, if you're at this school, you're probably already pretty hardworking. And I don't want to be like, you just got to work hard because you guys already know that. And so I guess I want to tell you guys something different. So this talk, it'll be more about maybe vulnerability or rejection or failure. I don't know. We'll see. Yeah, there we go. So I wanted to show you guys this. This is really cool. So this was the teacher I used to take class at. Now he has his own art school. His name was Tony Yao. That's me right there. So basically, it was pretty cheap. It was like $500 for like a 10-week course, you know, and it was like a really good education. So in 10 weeks, we had to make this. And this was on top of normal schoolwork. So we had cool artwork. We made models. Man, this is like really good. That wasn't mine. This is mine though. This is not as good, but still it got chosen to be in the art gallery, which is really cool. And yeah, people, my classmates, they're really good. This is me. I got in the photo. But I guess you can kind of see why, how do I do this? High school designers. Why I was into theme park design, because we were already building exhibits and stuff. I didn't do this, but they were already building like kind of immersive exhibits. And then that led me to do booth while I was at CMU. And then booth eventually led me to do theme park design. Oh my God, this is pretty good for high school kids, right? Okay, so story. Let's see, what else? Yeah, okay. So then high school years, they were tough, worked pretty hard. I was really lucky, by the way. I guess I want to put that out there. I lived in California, and like that's where the entertainment industry is located. So I was really, really lucky to have those opportunities. Eventually, I did go into Carnegie Mellon, and I was pretty confident. I got a 70K scholarship. That's half, so that's pretty good. There were some people who got like full scholarship, and I was jealous of them. Again, this competitive jealousy thing is a theme that's recurrent throughout my life. It's not good. But you know, I'm just being honest with you guys. So I was really surprised when I got bad grades. And I wanted to show this to you guys because it makes me more human, right? This is in studio with Kristen and Steve. And thanks. It was funny because this was like for a map project. And you know, like people have like ratings on YouTube. They gave us these post-it notes and they put the work on the wall and they're like, go rate your classmates' work. And I got 4 sticky notes, which was pretty good because I think some people got 5, some people got 2 sticky notes. And that was kind of like, oh cool, how popular people think you're, how good you are. And I got 4, so I was like, oh man, like this is in the bag. And I got this and I was like, oh my God. Oh, this kind of sucks because I tried really hard. And like in the end, I guess I kind of cheated because I used Photoshop. I didn't get the assignment. And it wasn't because I participated in class and stuff, but in the end, they were like, yeah, you didn't get the project. It wasn't because you didn't try hard. I just didn't get it. And I didn't. There was a lot of stuff at CMU where I didn't get. This one, this is really weird, dude. I got an A here, but a D here. So sometimes it's like there's stuff. It's not that I didn't try. Sometimes I wasn't engaged, or I just didn't get what the instructor wanted. So I did struggle here. Even though you might have been like, oh wow, this guy, like what a show off, you know? He did so well in high school. When I came here, it was really hard. Here, C and B. Okay, that's pretty good, right? but yeah, it was definitely pretty hard. And I was like, you know, F this, you know? I went to do other stuff. Like I joined clubs like ASA. I did graphic design when I was a freshman for them. I eventually did booth chair my freshman, sophomore, junior year. And I did a little bit senior year. And I also did freelance, what is it called? And IFS, International Freestyler. So I danced a lot, you know, did a lot of like DS and stuff like that. It was just more interesting to me because I guess what's kind of different is I was doing art since I was 6 years old. And compared to people who just started doing art, they're really passionate about it. You know, it's new to them, it's fresh. And like, but to me, I was like, oh my God, I've been like competing my entire life, ever since I was a kid, right? I was like, how do I become number one? And like, I was competing. And after I got to college, I was kind of burned out. I was like, dude, I don't even want to try anymore, you know? Like, I wanted to do something different. So this is what I did. This is my work at Carnegie Mellon. Maybe you've seen this kind of stuff before. It's pretty normal, right? You guys draw plants and stuff, right? You do this kind of drawing stuff. oh, this is for like a grocery project. So it was pretty fun, but I didn't have like the best time here. And like this is for this thing, it was like kind of arts and crafts, but it was like an independent project thing. So I had it was fun to kind of do, but as you can see, it wasn't the same type of work I was used to doing. And it was really frustrating to me. And this is my senior like course for Nissan. And this is supposed to be like the coolest thing. And I really, my group project was really cool. I love my group mates. But at the same time, you know, it was, you know, it's like a pedal thing. I don't think I was using my skills to the full, you know, to my fullest potential. I want to thank my senior teacher, Steve. He believed in me, like when I had questions about booth, like I wanted to make some kind of mechanical game, he would help me out. And I said I wanted to do concept art for my senior project, and he was like, okay, cool. And that was really cool because I didn't think he'd encourage it, but basically this is what I did for my senior project. I did like this concept art stuff. That was really cool. And I guess the point was I kicked ass in high school, but when I came to CMU, I like really tripped. You know, I really tripped when I was at CMU. I guess that was the point I wanted to make. And if you guys are doing bad in your classes, I want to say like I've been there. I'm not telling you like it's okay, go ahead and get Fs and stuff. You know, I'm just saying like, hey, I know it sucks and I've been there, and I just want to say I'm with you guys. You know, I guess that's my message. That's why I wanted to show you guys my bad report cards. During the summers, though, I did take some class at, this is a place called Concept Design Academy. And here, let me show you guys the link. It's so cool. It's super cool, you guys. Have you guys heard of this something called Marvel? Yeah. Called Avengers? Okay. Oh, how come it's not loading? All right. Anyways, it's this school in Pasadena. It's basically like art center where you can take class with like in the entertainment industry, but it's like 10 weeks, $500, $600 with like really good professors and stuff. This guy, Ryan Meinerding, you can take a class with him for $120, $120, like a workshop for like an afternoon. He's like the head of like Marvel visual development. And it's like a super cool opportunity. The teacher I took class with, his name was Jared Marantes. It was like the only class I can get into because I didn't qualify for the advanced class. But he does a lot of like movie stuff, you know, for like crazy sci-fi. It's like really, you know, realistic stuff. So he was a great teacher. It's all good. And basically, this is the stuff I did in his class, so I can give you guys some context. And okay. And lastly, I'll show you guys booth. We'll be right back.
Laughter.
Surrender now, or we will never find us.
Me, Ralph, that's right!
You guys know what booth is?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I would say that my education at CMU was worth it just purely based on my stuff in booth. To work, it's basically like ETC. But I would think, well, I don't know what the ETC is like, but I would say it's even better because this is what I liked about, I can't say it's better because I don't know what ETC is like, but this is the reason why I like booth. So you get to work with people from all different disciplines, engineering, business, chemistry, you know, everywhere, right? Basically like ETC. And then you build real world projects. And actually, even its funding is partially by itself, we have to fund it too, you know? So we learned business. Basically we had like the cookie sales and whatever, but we mostly made money selling club parties and like alcohol and stuff. Like that's where the money really is. Because this costs like $3,000 to $5,000 to make like one of these things, and that's actually really cheap for a structure like that. If we were to build like a theme park structure, about like a 300 square foot, it probably costs like $30,000 to build something like this. But yeah, it was just really cool, and I did that for like all 4 years, so I learned a lot of experience and just a lot of, you know, like when you're working on a team project, it's really hard. There's a lot of drama and stuff. It was like that, you know? There was definitely a lot of drama, and that was something to, it really helped. So I made this video after I graduated CMU, because I thought it would help me get a job. I spent a lot of time editing it, you know? And I thought I was gonna, but I didn't. I didn't. So I didn't get a job out of college. And I guess what I wanted to say was, one myth that I was fed for a while was it's not who you know, but what you know. But I personally think that networking and skill both matter. There definitely are exceptions when, a lot of people, they say, oh, there's like these people at my office and they're so like not talented, they totally suck, you know, but they got through networking. And that's what a lot of like the career center tells you that. And so I was like, yes, I'm gonna just network. I'm not gonna focus on school. I'm gonna get bad grades, you know. I'm gonna do booth, meet a lot of people. I knew people from like who worked at Deloitte, you know, like big companies. I knew people at Blizzard, DreamWorks, Disney, you know. I was like, okay, I'm set. You know, it's all about who you know, not what you know. And then when I applied to jobs, I was like, oh shoot, I don't really have a solid portfolio because I was kind of, you know, half-assing my way through college. And I wasn't really, I didn't really know what to do. And sorry, this presentation is a little bit incoherent, I know. It kind of goes all over the place. It's my first presentation, but there'll be some good nuggets in the end, I hope. A lot of this stuff, I haven't really told any of my friends, by the way, because no one goes around saying like, oh, I was such a badass in high school, and in college I got D's and C's. Like, that's not really a conversation topic. But I feel like it might be germane to you guys, the situation. Let's see. Oh, so what did I do 4 years after college? I happened to have made a video explaining all of that in 6 minutes. So, yes.
Okay, so it's been 4 years since I graduated from college. What have I done? What have I learned? Every year, I do write a reflection upon my year, and I'm going to use that as my resource to kind of reflect upon those years.
Okay.
So I graduated from Carnegie Mellon in 2010, and when I graduated, I moved back to California with my parents, and I just kind of hung around and just kind of relaxed, you know. I figured I would quickly get a job and then move out and, you know, just go on with my life. I was really optimistic about the world then. Everything was going great. In 2011, I realized that getting a job wasn't as easy as I thought it was. I realized I wasn't good enough and started taking a bunch of classes. Glenn Orbig at Three Kicks Art Studio, Watts Atelier, Studio Second Street, just a bunch of different figure drawing, charcoal, figure painting classes, you know, foundational stuff. To pay for all these classes, I started taking up a job at Disneyland. As a name painter, and that was really fun. And I eventually started working as a concept artist for some video games. I was a freelance concept artist, and that was actually kind of fun, but I actually didn't really like video games. I just wasn't really that into it. It was my dream job at the time, and I discovered that I don't really like doing it. Overall, 2011 was a really bitter year for me. If you read my 2011 Facebook post, I'm saying like, fuck Facebook, I hate Facebook, fuck you. You know, it was a really bitter year for me just because I was working so hard, and it just didn't feel right. In 2012, I had a hyper social life. I went the other way. I went to Big Bear, Anime Expo, Comic Con. I threw my first birthday party in like forever. I did this event on the Queen Mary, this workshop. I went to San Francisco for a Massive Black workshop, which was really crazy and fun. I even visited my friend James in New York and visited a bunch of old classmates and stuff there. It was super fun. It was super crazy that entire year. So during that year, I also watched a ton of videos on how to pick up girls. There's this channel called Simple Pickup that I absolutely love. It was like about like dorky Asian guys picking up girls. I don't know how to say this. I'm so embarrassed. During that year alone, I've gotten like more numbers than my entire life combined, and it was just because I really put myself out there. I asked, I got rejected maybe like 40, 50 times, I don't know, probably even more than that. Eventually, it was really emotionally abusive to myself and maybe to other girls as well. You get rejected so many times. I don't know, I have mixed feelings about it. I also was taking art classes at LAFA with Sean Cheatham and Nathan Folks at the same time that year. And that was really fun, did a lot of really cool paintings then. I also took class at Cazone in Irvine, and I took class with Matias and Charles Lee, and did a lot of cool digital paintings. So during that year, I focused on you know, less traditional stuff, but more on the digital stuff, because I really wanted to get my concept art illustration down. Here are some more paintings and sketches. Again, I was primarily trying to focus on doing more digital work. I also worked on something called the Teen Titans Project, where I did some character design for it. I also started working at Disneyland, doing some more caricatures, which was fun. And I also worked on this commercial for an organization called SACE, where I did some character designs and storyboards. So 2013 was the year of heartache. Remember how I told you I had mixed feelings about picking up girls? Well, it did end up biting me in the ass in the end. I don't know if I can blame it on that, because people have horrible relationships if you learn pickup lines or not. Yeah, I think I spent over a year getting over this girl. I read a bunch of books on like relationships, love, compassion, empathy, authenticity, tons of books. Trying to figure out what the problem was. Just because I can get someone's number doesn't mean that you're good at being in a relationship. Career-wise, something I'm more comfortable with, I decided to really focus on getting a theme park job. So I made all these resources on how to get it. I interviewed people. I was able to ask this professional theme park illustrator, Greg Pro, and he gave me like tips and critique and everything. Much special thanks, I created a theme park portfolio, submitted to companies, and by June, I got my first theme park job. I also worked at another three firms, Goddard Group, Thinkwell, and Mousetrap in 2013. So that was a really great career year for me. Also, in terms of physical health, I did a lot of running that year with my friends Heather and Peter. I went up to San Francisco again, Lake Tahoe, for Tough Mudder, and that was really fun. I also worked on my Legend Brush name painting, and I did a lot of online sales. I went to like different farmers markets and everything there, and really grew my business. 2014 is this year, and I started the year off really good. I went to Guatemala, to charity, mural painting, whatever. It was really awesome. Yo viví en Guatemala por una semana. I think this year I've been really focusing on making a lot of YouTube videos with my friends Bridget and Jonathan, Project Life Coach, and 6K Bede. We've been really focusing on making money. My Legend Brush business has been growing a lot as well. Sales has been good. So if I were to really summarize what I've learned these 4 years, I would say, for one, it's not just about working, and it's not just about having fun, and it's not all about just achieving things, and maybe life is about giving back and helping other people. I wish I would hang out with friends more. I know after college, a lot of people experience your friends and stuff kind of grow apart. It's kind of hard to make new friends when you're an adult versus when you're in college. But I think if I can make an effort into hanging out with friends more, that can happen. Also, right now, I don't spend as much time working out and being in good physical health, and that's something I want to work on as well. Okay, this video is like super hard to get together, because how are you gonna like condense 4 years into like a freaking 10 minute video? It's hard. So yeah, props for me. Self love. High five. See you later. So the reason why I wanted to show you guys that video was because I feel like I want to talk about myself as a person, not just as a designer. A lot of times, you know, the professors, right? You just kind of see one side dimension of them. Like, they're just up there teaching. But in real life, you don't know. Maybe like they're doing a divorce with their wife or husband. You know, they may be going through some rough times, you know, or like your friends, maybe someone's depressed or bipolar or has suicidal tendencies. Like, you never know what's going on with other people's lives. But, you know, I just want to say, like, you know, I go through shit too. You know, it's I guess this talk is really about like reaching out and being empathetic. Not just, hey, this is all my good work, but I want to show you some like garbage and some shit as well, to be like, hey, like, if you go through tough stuff, just know that, you know, there's other people just like you. You know, you're not a failure if, you know, this thing doesn't work out or that thing doesn't work out. Let me see. Let's see. Do I want to talk about this? Do you guys want to see this work? Yeah? Okay. Okay, so basically the story is, I emailed this company called Goddard Group, and one of the people in the class, I guess, had the same instructor, and it was super cool, and he emailed me back looking at my portfolio, and he was like, hey, your stuff's pretty good, but if you want to get a job, you should look at this illustrator. His name's Greg Pro, and so basically, I stalked the heck out of Greg Pro. Like, I copied his work to the point where I kept on posting it on my blog. If you searched his name, my blog would come up first. And basically, I think he was searching his own name, and he saw the blog post, and then he commented below, like, on my thing. And I was like, oh, that's so cool. He was like, oh, why are you copying this hack? You know, he was kind of being, like, sarcastic. And eventually, I reached out to him and stuff. But basically, I was so obsessed with this guy to the point where I found out his teacher's name was Fred Fixler. And he was like this teacher in New York. And I found that at one of the local art schools in LA, that's an hour, so if that's local, there was a guy who also learned from the same art teacher. So I'm like, oh, okay. So same art teacher as the guy who I want to emulate. Okay, I'll take class with him, you know? Because I was trying to be really serious about getting good. And, you know, if it's like, if this person went to Carnegie Mellon and now they're the Nobel Prize winner, like, I'll go to Carnegie Mellon too. So I was kind of doing that. So yeah, I took class at this place called 3 Kicks Art Studio. And like, I even took class with this, his name was Glenn Orbick. He was Greg Pro's roommate, and I even took class with Jeff Watts, who was the student of Glenn Orbick. But anyways, it was like there's a lot of connections, and I was just doing a bunch of research like a detective, like finding everything out. But yeah, I was taking class at a bunch of wow, there's like a lot of, do you guys enjoy this? Okay, cool, because I know a lot of professors, they don't really show you their work, right? They just kind of talk in riddles. And they don't tell you what the assignment should look like. They're like, you guys, figure it out. Let me tell you, it's like Mr. Miyagi every day, right?
I noticed that professors don't really talk about their personal lives or their professional experience, and they don't really show you, you know, their work. But in LA, a lot of the professors, they do this format. Basically, it's a lecture slash demo. So they talk about themselves, their personal life, like, oh, I grew up in Russia where you had to sleep on the floor and there was ice everywhere. And I made like 1 cent an hour, you know, but then I got found art and it was my passion. You know? Like a lot of talks are like that. And then they become like really good. They're like, I never had an art teacher. I just looked at art books and I got good. I just studied like 14 hours a day. And it's really inspirational, really, you know? But that's like the format. And they're like, oh, okay, now I'm gonna show you how I paint. You know, this is my own style. I invented it. No one taught me. I just worked really hard. And they do that. So I think it's really good for learning because you first understand them as a person and then you see them work. And then it's like, oh, I get it. That's why this person works that way. So that's what I wanna do now. Let me show you where I took classes. If you want to take class, you can take there too. I like to be really specific and concrete while I'm doing like lecture stuff. So I took class here. It's really cool. I also took class here, Three Kicks Art Studio. And basically this is what you learn. It's really cool because a lot of these teachers, like let's say you take a class at a place that teaches concept design, right? And like these people, they know how to do figure drawing. Well, guess what? These people sell their figure drawings and stuff for like $10,000. They're professional figure drawers or professional painters. It's like they're not an industrial designer who does some figure drawing on the side. Like they are a fine artist, you know? Like what some of these people, like Edgar Sylvia, I think he's a fine artist. He does like art galleries and stuff. So all he does is paint people, and like I was like, oh, okay, cool. Instead of taking someone who does this drawing stuff part-time, why not take class from someone who does it full-time? Like this guy, Richard Morris, I think he's a gallery artist. I don't know how much he makes per drawing, but maybe like $5,000 or $10,000 for his drawings. So I was like, oh, cool. Let's take class with a professional drawer. This same thing for here. This is like an atelier class, you know, it's like super good, you know, and this is only like $300 for like a 10-week class, like super affordable. You can always take the class during the summer and stuff, Airbnb it. Another teacher, Ron Lemon. Oh, the story is there weren't a lot of people taking the class. At one point, I think 5 people signed up. It was like $295 for 10 weeks. And on the last week, it was like 2 people in the class. And he gave me like an hour demo in my sketchbook. And I was like, wow. Like, I just had like a private lesson, you know? Like, imagine in like your design class, right? If you had like 2 people in your class with your professor and he comes down and draws in your sketchbook, I was like, wow, this is like a great deal. There's another class. Have you heard of this place? Yeah? Yeah. But yeah, I would still attribute my aggressiveness and like my ability to research and stuff with Carnegie Mellon, because you know I wasn't just drawing all day, I was thinking critically. Like if I want to be good, you know, I was using that like critical thinkingness to improve my art. Let's see. Okay. Let me show you some more. So this is like plein air paintings, which means painting from life. Let me show you some of my instructor's work, and then I'll show you my work, and then it'll make sense. This guy's name is Ed Lee. So he's worked on stuff like, I forgot, but a bunch of like Disney movies and stuff, Princess and the Frog, you know, so really cool. So I took class with him, and it was basically you go outside and you sketch, and it was like the funnest class I've ever taken. It was like a vacation every class. One of the funnest class I've ever taken. Oops, what'd I do? But yeah, I gotta take class with him. This is another, I'd learned painting from this guy, and it was really cool. He does these paintings. Oh, this is super cool, you guys. So watch this. What do you think of this photo? It's not a photo. I saw this on like Instagram or Facebook before, and I'm like, why is he posting like a stupid photo? And then I was like, oh shoot, it's not a photo. Okay, so you can see it's like kind of, you know, so this is like his steps. Like he does this, and then like, it's really like unapologetically computer. Like it looks Photoshop, but it's really unapologetic about it. It's like, yes, I use lasso tool. Yes, there's no brush strokes. It's all about digitalness. And like, wow, he's so confident in just being himself with the medium. So I really like this guy. And he worked for like Disney and stuff too. Let's see. Oh, Nathan Folks. I love this teacher. He worked on stuff for like DreamWorks and stuff. Great color. It's still loading. We'll go back to it. Oh, this is the guy, Greg Pro. This is like, so he advocated plein air painting. So I'm like, well, if this guy tells me to do plein air painting, I'm going to do plein air painting. And this is his work. He does theme parks and stuff. So I was like, okay, if he tells me to jump through a loop, I'm going to jump through that loop, you know? Like anything this guy's, like he was really good, right? So I was like, okay, if he says to do it, I'll do it. So you'll see. And this is Dice Susumi. Have you guys heard of this guy?
Yeah.
Okay, so he does like Toy Story and stuff. Like, as you can see, this is also unapologetically digital. You can see a bunch of like hard edges and stuff. You know, it's like these hard edges. It's like a lasso tool. It doesn't look like something traditionally painted, but he's like, that's what it is. Oh, Nathan Folks, look at his color. It's so beautiful. And so I was so privileged that I was living in LA at the time and I was able to take class with these really brilliant instructors. Yeah? Okay, so this is a lot of classwork I did from the class. Or I stood from the class. So this is like painting from life, and it doesn't look really exciting, but it's actually really hard to do this. If you try it, you'll know. It's like a push-up, it looks easy. Or gymnastics. Gymnastics look easy, but when you do them, it's hard. Oh, this is really cool. So I did a sketch, and then as I was painting, I was testing the color here, and this is like a local pool. I hope you guys like these things. Because I know the instructors here, you know, don't show art really often, right? They don't show you their personal work. So I wanted to show you like all my personal work in like 2 hours. So this is a copy of Nathan Folk. So I would copy my instructor's stuff. They don't let you copy things here in the design department. They want you to think of everything yourself, which is a good skill to have, but not very efficient. Especially if the, I was talking with my professor, how like I appreciate the design thinking, because there's a lot of answers in life. There's a lot of problems in life where you don't know the answer. But in certain situations, when you do have an answer, I started to take advantage of that. It's like, okay, if this person works at Disney and their drawings look like this, I'm just gonna make my drawings look like that person, and I'll, you know, get the job, because it's like, oh, cool. He can come to our studio. This kind of looks like we can use you. But then in some projects where it's like, we don't have no idea what this theme park is going to look like, then, you know, the design thinking kind of helps, because you're like, oh, shoot, I don't know what the answer is. And you have to figure stuff out. So, yeah. What the? It's like a repeat. Oh, this is a Dice Susumi copy. The Pixar guy. So a lot of this stuff you see here, it's a lot about the black and white images. To kind of explain it, you know how it's like really polarized, like really black and white? The reason why they do that is because in the old days, when they would do like comic book, like novel covers or like billboards, it needs to read from really far away. So it made sense at the time, you know? It looks more like a poster, like vectors, right? It reads well from really far away. When you do like vector posters, it reads well. And again, you know how it's like only black and white? The same thing, like for the illustrations, they want them to read like posters, almost like vector images. What the, is it again? You guys seen this stuff, right? Yeah. Oh, this is a copy of Greg Pro. More copies. Yeah, I love this guy. He was so cool. Okay. Gouache. Good question. If anyone has questions, raise your hand.
What scale are you working in?
They're very small.
This big?
No way.
Yeah. Do I have anything to... Shoot, I don't have anything to show you. But yes, they're very small. Oh, okay, so myth number two. You know how people always tell you to like draw every day, right? I learned that drawing and... So the myth was foundation and drawing every day is the key to success. But then I was like, okay, yes, you need to have the sketching, painting foundation, but you also need to be able to contribute to projects and produce actual concept art, preferably in digital format. So basically, I was like, so my epiphany when I was at a massive, I was at an art workshop, you know, it was like a top tier workshop with a bunch of, it's like those guys, like, but like 2 days worth of them, like entire lectures, like all day. And so on the side, there would be like figure drawing. And one of the guys is from Blizzard. Do you guys know Blizzard? WoW, Warcraft, Starcraft, right? So I'm like, wow, this guy's drawings must be really good. And I was watching him draw like the figure, the drawing model. And I was like, wait a second. Like his drawings are okay. I think I can draw just about as good or better. And then I was like, how come he has a job at Blizzard and I don't? And then I was like, oh, it's because I don't do concept art. Like, I realized, like, no one's gonna be like, yo, your figure drawings are pretty good. I like your naked guys. Let's have you draw some spaceships for us. Like, it doesn't really make sense, you know? Like, oh, I love your mountains, really good mountains. We're gonna have you come on to, I don't know, what's something you do? Like, design Toy Story. Like, in back in the day, I think it used to be like that because the artists, they were so rare. You know, pre-internet, it was hard to find artists. So if they saw that you had good fundamentals, they'd hire you. But nowadays, have you guys heard of like stuff like CG Hub or ArtStation or whatever?
Yeah.
Let me show you guys real quick. So like, these are the people I was competing with, like people this good. What's my point? I was like, oh, okay. My point was you need to be able to do this too. Like this kind of stuff, not just this. Because the instructors were like, okay, so it's like being in a, let's say you're fighting, right? Like the guy's like, oh, you need to be able to do push-ups, right? So you do push-ups, but then like when you get into the ring to fight, it's like, oh shoot, I never trained at fighting. It's like, I can do like, bunch of push-ups, but you also need to be able to like fight, you know, do the actual job. I think it applies too. So maybe you can do the design thinking, but you also need to be able to perform when your employer is like, all right, man, we have 5 days to design this, get at it, you know, and you need to be able to perform, not just talk about how intellectual or big ideas or big picture thinking. I think that stuff works. I've seen a lot of people work at like Facebook and LinkedIn and stuff. So I don't know about like apps and UX and UI. So maybe it works for that. But for the concept art industry, you gotta do it. So this was my attempt at doing actual concept art. It's okay. It wasn't anything special, you know. I was trying to, you know, it's not really anything special. It's like, okay. I think in my 4-year reflection video, I said that I was trying to do video game design. But I didn't play any video games, so it was kind of hard. Oh, I love this piece. It's like digital, you know? It's really Photoshop-y. And so I was like playing digital, and I was struggling with it. So this is my portfolio in 2013. This is some freelance work for a video game project. That was stuff for a class. So I was like, oh, I'm making video game stuff. But I really wanted to work on theme parks maybe because I did booth. And my epiphany was one of my art teachers, it was Nathan Folks. He looked at my portfolio and I was like, what do you think, man? And you know, I expected him to be like, oh, you're painting form, shadow, line here and do this and do that. He simply said like, so what do you want to be? And then I was like, well, I want to be a theme park designer. And he was like, I would have thought you wanted to be a video game or movie designer. And I was like, oh my God, that's so simple. I need to have some theme parks in my portfolio. You know, it's kind of silly. It's like, I was trying to just copy other people's work, like the art station thing. You see this? I was like, oh, you draw mechs? I'm gonna do that too, you know? But I wasn't really thinking critically, right? And that's what we learn at CMU, to think critically. You know, question what hasn't been questioned before. So I started focusing on theme parks. And I was like, but I don't know any teachers who do theme parks. You know, I don't know anyone besides this one guy, Greg Pro. There's not a lot of people out there. You know, because if you're at Disney Imagineering, a lot of people, they don't post, because they're already at Disney Imagineering. They don't need to post a portfolio or job. And they can't post any of their professional work online. And a lot of concept artists who do theme parks, they're not allowed to sign their work. So if I like something, I don't know who it is. I can't look them up. Anyways, so my turning point was basically to focus on theme parks. And this was my inspiration. Have you guys heard of Katie Rogers? She was an alum at CMU. She did LG Lunar Gala. Let's check it out. I like to take inspiration from a lot of different places. So she does something called paper fashion. What is this? So this is what she does. And she has like 900,000 likes. She's done stuff for like Chanel and like her work looks like this. Really impressive. She does illustration and she does fashion. Those are like the two most, like the hardest industries to get into, you know? Like fashion is really hard, right? But I was like, wow, if she can just do whatever she wants, I can do whatever I want too. And she was like using glitter and nail polish. Like if Mark Baskinger saw this, you know, he'd like vomit, right? Because he would make fun of like glitter and like bling and stuff a lot in design class. And I was like, she was using glitter in LG. She was using like glitter and stuff here. And it's like, oh my God, she just doesn't care about what other, she like, I guess she like followed her heart, you know? Like I don't really like know her process, but I was really inspired. Like if she can make a living doing that, I can make a living doing theme parks. I didn't know how, so I started researching. So, this is really good. Okay, this is another video. I think it's good. It got a lot of likes and shares, so I'll share this with you guys.
Hey guys, Chris Chien here. Today I'm gonna show you a shortcut on how to get an art job. All right, so what we're gonna be using today is the golden rule of business, which is to understand your customer. You know, you gotta put yourself in your customer's place. And basically, what I see a lot of people doing is that they first do all the learning and they build the portfolio, and as an afterthought, then they reach out to the client to see what they want and they submit their portfolio. What I'm suggesting otherwise is to first research the client, find out what they want, just kind of like when you apply to college, you figure out what are the requirements, and then you go about and learn the things you need to learn and build a portfolio that's going to get you the job. Step one is to first research the customer. Yeah, let's say I wanted to be a video game designer or animation studio. Of course, there's like the big studios like Disney and Pixar and stuff, but there's also a ton of small ones. Okay, so let's search animation studio LA. And we have like a bunch of search results. 6-point harness, duck, Acme, animation, you know, there's a bunch of stuff out there. Okay, so we see on this website, you know, there's an entire list of all these different studios. You know, like, even if you cannot get to, let's say, like, Disney, there's 50 other places that you can get a job at. Alright, here's a place called Duck Studios, and you can, of course, contact them. Mm-hmm. 6-point harness, Acme, jobs, all the phone numbers and stuff, they're all here. Okay, and if you want to be a video game designer, of course, the same thing. And here's a list of a bunch of companies. There's so many. And these are local for LA area. You know, there's big companies such as like Naughty Dog, and there's smaller companies, Nexon, I don't know, Entertainment Labs, Santa Monica, Quicksilver Entertainment, Ready at Dawn Studios, Red 5, you know, some I heard of, you know, and some I haven't. And there's like just so many opportunities out there, you know, and you need to do your research. Research the industry overall, you know, and then research the companies, find out the games they've worked on and stuff, okay? You gotta understand your customer, which is these companies. Alright, second, you wanna learn about the people that they hire. Instead of just speculating, asking teachers, why don't you find out who actually works at the company and look at their portfolio? For example, let's say I wanted to work at Sony Santa Monica, okay? Let's say I like God of War. I've never played it, but let's just pretend I have.
Go to LinkedIn.com.
Okay, so in my search engine, I'm gonna search Sony Santa Monica. And here's a list of all these people who've worked there. And by contacting these people, you can find out what is the standard of work, what is the minimum standard you need to be at to work at this company. You can see your contact info. So if you wanted to work on Sony God of War, this is what your artwork needs to look like. Kevin Chien. And it's really cool because you get to see their entire background of all the different companies that they worked at before. Okay, so far we learned that we can use Google to find out about the industry and find out about, you know, 50 plus different companies that you can work at. Second, we figured out how to use LinkedIn to, you know, search like the employees who currently work at the company. And you can, you know, use LinkedIn to, of course, Google their name, or there's right there, you can find out what their portfolio looks like. Third, let's establish a relationship with some of these people and, you know, ask them some questions. Yeah, so what I typically would like to do is I'd like to first check out their blog, their portfolio website, and if I really like their work, you know, and I feel like, wow, I kind of want to, you know, be like this person, I'd send them an email, first complimenting them, saying like, oh, I've looked at your blog, you know, I really like the game studio you worked at, it's super cool, I really admire you. And then I would, you know, ask for their opinion. No one likes to give away shit for free except their opinion. People love to give away their opinion. You know, ask them, what do you think is the ideal portfolio? What does the ideal portfolio look like? I might talk about myself a little bit, saying like, oh, I'm an art student at this art school, you know, and this is what my portfolio looks like, I'm studying, you know, ask them some questions. And you want to develop a relationship with this person. If this person responds, maybe in a couple emails, you need to find ask them really important information, such as who is in charge of hiring. You know, is it the art director or maybe it's a human resources person? You need to ask, what does the ideal portfolio, what does the ideal job candidate look like, you know? Again, we're thinking about their point of view. What are they looking for? What are their inner desires as a company, you know, as an employer? How can I deliver on that? So lastly, you want to, for step four, is deliver on their desires. So if they tell you, give you advice, go ahead, follow their advice, you know? They might give you feedback like, oh, you know, your artwork, if you want to work for us, you need to learn 3D or whatever. Maybe they say, oh, hey, if you want to work for us, you need to learn animation and traditional drawing skills, you know? Or maybe they say, oh, you need to be really good at storytelling. Every company is going to tell you something different. And a big mistake I see a lot of students doing is that they listen to like all these different and they combine it together like a big mushy salad. You got to realize that, you know, these are all different employers and customers, and create that ideal portfolio, you know? So basically, you do the client research, and then you build a portfolio, you know? Just like, if I'm going to do an illustration, first I gather reference images, right? And then after I gather all my references, then I do the illustration. This is kind of the same thing. Before I build my portfolio, first I do my client research, you know? I gather my references, like, oh, this is what the ideal portfolio should look like. These are the kind of drawings I need. Then I go build it. It just makes more sense that way. I don't know why people don't do that. I think it's because artists like to be free and want to do their own thing and stuff. So yeah, that's about it. Just to give you a little background about myself. Back in 2012, I was taking a class with Nathan Folks and I showed him my portfolio. And it wasn't a bad portfolio. He simply asked me, hey, so what do you want to do? And I said, I want to be a theme park designer. And he said, well, you know, your portfolio kind of looks like a video game design portfolio. And then I was like, wow, you are absolutely right. You know, I didn't have any like theme park designs in my portfolio. So I started doing those theme park illustrations. And I did a lot of research. I went to theme park conventions. I bought books and blogs. And I learned all this research, did all this research on these different companies. I talked to theme park illustrators. I came up with only 3 illustrations, you know, and I got a job, you know. So, of course, if you don't have the foundational art skills and techniques, you need to work on that. But if you already have that, you probably aren't too far away from getting a job. You know, you just need to be do your research, you know, and treat the employer as a customer and give the customer what they need. You know, you're helping people with your skills. All right. And yeah, that's about it. I feel like this workflow, this methodology is really precise. You know, it's kind of like you are, if you're driving someplace, you first GPS the directions, you know, you ask for the directions and then you go, you know, and it's really focused. Like you're like a sniper rifle. You're not going for everything. You pick your focus and you just get it. You know, you focus on it. And yeah, that's it. Well, anyways, I've actually worked on this video. I worked on this content for about a year. You know, if you have any questions, feel free to let me know. I'm glad to help. You know, I'm finally happy to get this over with, actually. All right, talk to you later. Bye.
Does anyone have any questions? All right, I'll show you my process on what I did, okay? So, I was... let me see... So, what's really funny is that, let's say, if you were to go to a girl you like, right, or a guy, and you were like, oh, you know, I saw that last week you went to Vegas, and that's really cool, I saw you got new shoes or whatever, like, oh, blah, blah, and I know you like One Direction or whatever, you know, it seems kind of creepy. But if you went to a company, and you were like, oh, that project you worked on in like 1987 when you guys were founded, that was, you know, your turning point, and I saw you guys got acquired by this company and that, and I noticed like you have this position, you know, like, can you tell me more about, you know, your values of the company and your mission statement? They'll be like, oh, hell yeah, we'll hire this guy. This guy like really knows his stuff. So it's like everything you don't want to do on the first date, you can do with a company, and they actually take it well. Like if you are like sending them emails constantly, like let's say if it's like a person you like, right? They'll be like, man, this guy is so needy. They're like, oh, he won't stop texting me, right? But then if you're at a company and like I email them maybe 3 times a year, right? And like every year, they'll be like, wow, this guy's so persistent. You know, you keep it up, Chris. You know, that's so good. You are constantly emailing us. Keep, you know, it's kind of funny, but that's kind of, yeah. Don't do your dating life exactly like your job search. So check it out. These are all the theme park companies that I found. Wait, who here thinks that it's hard to get a job as a concept artist? Right? But after this talk, I was like, dude, F that. There are so many companies out there. Like these are the companies I didn't keep on adding. I started here. 1, 2, 3. Like imagine if I would dare you, if you were to apply to all of these companies with a okay portfolio, you messaged everyone, called them up, would you think you would get rejected from all 20 or 40 of the companies, you know? Like if it was like a dare and I bet like $2,000, I think I would lose. I think one company would be like, yeah, we'll hire you. You know, like statistically, if you were to email this many companies with an adequate portfolio, I just feel like you know, maybe artists, they're just looking at 2 to 3 different companies. But from a sales perspective, I used to be a salesman at Disneyland, right? And basically what we learn, you know, during sales, it's like, you just gotta get rejected like 10, 20, 30, 40 times. Like another example is theater, right? Right, auditions, right? How many times do actors and actresses get rejected? Like, yeah, if they're not, yeah, right? But then maybe where I was talking to someone, like there's like 40 companies, like, oh, I emailed 40 companies, only 4 of them responded. That's fantastic, right? If you go to 40 auditions and you got 4 callbacks as an actress, that's pretty good. So I guess that's sales experience. I wanted to put that out there. Oh, these are all the concept illustrators. So I researched all my competition too. So these are all the illustrators. You know, alive and dead. And there's not that many, I found. There's much more in video game and stuff. So yes, design research. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? I know. Okay, okay. So basically, in what major are you?
Design.
Design. What? What year are you?
I'm a freshman.
Oh, okay, okay. So basically, in industrial design, right? If someone wants to design like a phone for someone, they'll be like an iPhone. They'll be like, okay, what is our ideal demographic? Oh, this person is an early adopter. They're 25 to 35 years old. With this is how much their income is, probably $25,000 to $70,000 a year. And they do their marketing ads and they design a product. They figure out everything about this person. And they do marketing. They really figure everything out. Does that sound like product design? Mm-hmm. Right? Do the same thing for your job search, and you're good. Like, cause like when we're doing like the image boards, right? It's like, oh, this person does yoga, walks a dog. The favorite song is probably this, and we're gonna design a car for this person. What would a car look like for this person if we were marketing for them, you know? Or like, oh, maybe this person is a toddler, or this person is a grandma, you know? And you find out like what are their needs? Do you understand them? Empathy, research. Yeah. Okay, so these were the new work things. And I'll show you guys my process. I think this is cool. Is this it? Oh. Interesting. Let me log in real quick. Oh, by the way, I think this is pretty cool. You can follow some companies on Facebook. Like this is a theme, ThinkWell. And you can follow this company on Facebook. And because I followed them, I found out they had an open house. And they also have a theme entertainment association in that I found out it exists. It's like IDSA, but for theme parks. And wow, yo, like I'm here for a conference right now. The ratio of professional to student is like, there's like 10 professionals to maybe every two students. It's like really good odds. It's like me going to CMU as a guy dating, but like the opposite and way better, you know? Cause you know like the guy girl ratio is like really skewed, right? More guy, pretty close now?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. But when you go to like conferences, right? There's usually a bunch of students and a couple employers, like job fairs, right? That job fair right now, what is it? It's like 100 students per every employer? Oh, okay. But that's what it looks like, right? When you walk past, there's like a swarm and but basically, I looked for where there wasn't that much competition. Okay. So check it out. So this is my sketch for the Lord of the Rings one. This is just pencil. So basically, one of the creative directors posted on an online article. The question was, are there any theme parks you would like to see? And he was like, well, I wish I would like to see a Lord of the Rings theme park and a Tron theme park. I think that would be cool. So I messaged him, you know, a couple months later. I was like, here you go, bam. But it wasn't like that. I was like, hey, I read on an article that you said this, you know, and I noticed I really like your company, and here are my ideas. What do you think? It was cool. He'd be like, yeah, let me put you in touch with our human resources director. Showed that I was sincere, I did my homework. Of course, I also want to say, some of you guys, hold on. Oh, this is really, see the difference? So the difference is that before I thought this was more artistic, and I emailed the theme park designer, Greg Pearl, right? And he was like, yo, dude, like the thing is for theme park design, you want to see the people and you want to see the tracks, you want to see them smiling. So I was like, okay. So right, before it's like so moody and artistic and cinematic, right? And he was like, no, you don't want that, not in theme parks. You need to see like happy, happy, you know? So I was like, wow, I'm glad I took his advice. For the next one, it was pretty cool. That was cool. I think this is a big difference. I was using like the computer, so it looks more like clean and modern. Look how sketchy this is, really sketchy, you know? Basically, I was doing a thing where I would just draw every day, and it didn't matter if it was 5 minutes or a minute or 2 hours, I wanted to do some progress. So sometimes you'll see like, there's not much that was going on, but I just wanted to do just a little bit, even if it was like 2 minutes. And you can see over here, it's day 34, you know, day 35, day 36. And you can see here, I took the guy's advice. He said, you want to see happy people? I'll show you happy people. Look at those people there. They're happy, you know? So yeah, it's like an advice from the person who you want a job from, I think is worth way more than someone who doesn't work in that industry. Because a lot of times, I won't say professor, but I'll ask a video game designer, like, what you think of my portfolio? And he'll tell me, like, oh, like, it needs to be, like, super photorealistic. Well, the thing is, when you work on Avatar and, like, different video games, it needs to be like that. But for Disney stuff, they want it super sketchy, you know? And he basically just gave me advice that it's not, like, bad, but it was just kind of, like, in the direction that I didn't want to go in, you know? You're getting advice from the wrong people. And basically, the advice I got from the right person is worth a ton. And sometimes, you know, you want to watch who you get. Like one time, right, this guy, he was saying, like, I did a piece. There was a castle in it. And he was a game designer. So he was like, you know, it would be really cool if kids can climb up the castle and stuff, you know, can go through there. But any theater or theme park designer, well, that's like a freaking hazard. There's no way you can climb up a castle. And then I was like, okay, in a video game, you can do that. And I realized, man, I can't ask this guy for advice anymore. Even though he's a great artist, I'm afraid he would steer me in the wrong direction. And actually, when I was doing this, I didn't go to any art class. I didn't ask any teachers for advice except theme park designers, because I wanted to be really focused and I wanted to get the right advice. You know how sometimes you get critiqued on your work so many different ways? This professor says this and the other professor said the exact opposite. It's like, what the heck am I supposed to do? Yeah, that's a problem. Did you guys see this? Okay. So usually those pieces you just saw took me about 50 hours.
Today I'll give you my process for this illustration. This is the sketch and this is the grayscale version of it. In this next version, you'll see that the tree and the mountains are scaled down because of it's going to be like a theme park, you know, it has to be practical. So now I'm starting the coloring section, blocking in basic colors. And now I'm just doing the people. Now this part is pretty straightforward, it just takes some time. And now I'm doing the sky. And coloring a little bit more of the people. Now I used a photo texture for the sky, so it looks more realistic and vivid. And now I'm working on the cherry blossoms. You can see that I'm actually using photos to create this effect. I'm doing a lot of cutting and pasting. And now I'm just working on some more values, incorporating some darker values. I just put in the fence on the left-hand side. Now I'm working on the cherry tree, the tree in the way back. I just made that edit to the little girl on the right. Added the kung fu training section on the right. And I put like a guy who looks like Harry Potter in there on the left. I think that looks pretty funny. And I'm using some photos from the people, doing some cast shadows on the ground, adding a couple of more silhouettes and people in the picture. And that's about it. So I did this back in 2014, and my client, you know, gave me permission to show this to you guys. So yeah, thanks.
Like in architecture, right? Architecture. Basically, they put in photo of the people, right? Yeah, see, it's not cheating. I mean, people have been doing it for ages, actually. Any questions so far? So the problem with that process was, as even though it looked good, I'd go into jobs and they'd be like, we need this in 2 days. And I'd be like, well, it usually takes me 50 hours. Doing it in 16 hours is about 4 times faster than what I normally can do. So I would do it, but I'd just be so exhausted. So I would find out ways and research ways how to work faster. I'd be like, hey, like Professor, you know, James, like how do you work? So, you know, I'd figure it out. And there's actually something called meta learning, called deconstructing and stuff. Let me just show you guys this. Picture is worth 1,000 words. Basically, this technique skips the line art stage. it skips a lot of stages. It's just go directly in.
Hey guys, so this is the first part of my concept art experiment. So right now I'm just getting reference and I'm figuring out live stream, and my first half an hour was just kind of figuring things out. Basically, I'm doing the James Paik method of gathering my research and putting it all on one PSD file. That's something James Paik did in his workshop. It's pretty interesting, and I'm just sketching in loosely so far. It's not as good as, it's not a really good sketch. Honestly, had to look a lot of research. Research took a long time. Maybe I spent too much time doing research, I don't know. But it's like, I had to research concept illustrations, I had to research, you know, Mega Man gameplay, and yeah, like I'm looking through a lot of like YouTube videos and stuff right now, and I'm getting screenshots and stuff, and I'm gonna use those textures in my painting later, right now. Okay, so I'm using them, and yeah, it helps me with perspective, so that was pretty cool, just getting perspective right off the bat, and then putting in like an extra wall, and you know, for scenic, I definitely see that being, you know, practical and easy to do. And there's some pipes, I think that's really good too. Oh, yeah, I'm doing like, I'm copying something and I'm duplicating it. That's something John Park did in his workshop for, it's pretty cool, James Paik did that too. So I laid in the texture so far. Looking back, I probably should have adjusted the values, but I thought that came, it was like, I thought it was a lighting pass, but whatever. So now I'm putting this in. And again, like the values and stuff, they don't look really good, but whatever. I'll learn next time. And now I'm putting in like the blasters and stuff. I'm putting people in, and I'm so bad at drawing people, but it looks okay. I figured it'll look okay after I put everything in, and this is like totally cheating, but you know, whatever. For this experiment, I'll just do that. And yeah, so this part was super fun, you know, because it's really surprising. I'm having a lot of fun, and that's definitely my goal. I definitely want to have fun and do this more. I have no idea what's going on. I love those fences. It makes it seem, I was thinking like maybe it's like a hub spoke design where you go in to each room and each room is like a level and a boss. And like this would be, what's that called? Trackless. So it could be trackless. So they go into each room and they go out and it resets again. So yeah, I'm thinking about like, just how it could be like Transformers ride plus Buzz Lightyear kind of thing. You know, so I'm thinking about Nintendo's building, Universal's building a Nintendo park, and how would Nintendo build their rides? It's a little bit different from how Disney would build them, so I'm thinking about that. So yeah, I took another break. So I'm about like 2 hours in so far, I think, 2 hours in so far, and I got a lot done. I'm pretty happy. So yeah, I put in all these, the bad guys in, and then right now I'm doing values. I should have done this earlier, because now I'm like, oh, it's so tedious, I have to do it all over again, so that was annoying, but yeah, I like this part actually, doing the values, yeah, just making things look kind of sexy, and just, so I'm adjusting like the depth for that now, making things look better and presentable, and I was thinking I was going to do this at the end, but I'd really rather do it along the way. Right now, yeah, I already added all the textures and all the photos and all the screenshots. And yeah, I think this part's looking pretty good. I'm really taking my time, making it look sexy and stuff like that. Yeah. And now when I put like the ride vehicle in, the boosters, I realized, oh man, it looks like crap. Well, this part looks really good, right? But yeah, that looks like crap. So I'm like, okay, now I have to completely fix that. So I do the lighting. I do a lot of adjustment layers. That's one thing James Paik did. He doesn't paint by hand, it's just adjustment layers. I do a little bit of hand painting to get that flavor in there. Oh, on the bottom, occlusion, ambient occlusion layer. Make sure to get that in. Some shadows, kind of desaturate it too, so it looks a little bit cooler. Just hue, put some fog, atmosphere, perspective. And yeah, so this part's looking pretty good. And then later, I add the effects and stuff, and but like, fuck, dude, I forgot to record the last part. So unfortunately, the last part, you don't see me do it. So this is what I have so far, and it looks pretty good. And then I have to add the people, right? I'll just show you the final. Here it is. This is the final.
And I forgot to record this part. It would have been cool. I think I went overboard on the effects a lot, but whatever. I have a lot more opportunities to do this. So what are some things that I learned? So the positive part of this process was that it was super fun. It was super exciting because usually I do line art and I know I figure everything out beforehand. But when I was doing like this photo bashing technique, I wasn't really sure. And it was very fast because I was designing and painting as I went along. And I had no idea how it was going to turn out. So it was very fun and interesting to me. It's kind of like freestyling in a dance circle, you know, you don't know how it's going to turn out. And at a 4-hour completion time, that's very fast. I did take a lot of breaks over the course of 3 days, but and only spent 4 hours on it. Eventually, by Sunday, I want to get to like 3 hours, no breaks, you know, 4 to 7, bam. And I think this is worth good money. Like something like this, I can see this being at least worth $500, maybe $1,000 if I improve my skills a little bit more. Maybe if it's even worth like $700 now, I don't know. But definitely it could be a really, you know, this will really boost my worth in terms of day rate. Okay, next is negative. Problem is, it didn't look good at high resolution. When you really zoom in close, forgot to screenshot the last one, all right? Next is what I learned. I need to do my composition value as I photo texture. Yeah, basically it means that like I went back to do values, whereas I wish I kind of just went along. It would have been more fun that way. I did spend a lot of time doing research, with only half hour, but I felt like I don't need to do too much research, otherwise it gets too confusing and I get too bogged down. I want to try to stick with my guns and just instinct and just make it up as I go. I think I'll try that next time. But mostly, if there's anything I learned, it's the make sure to do the lighting as I do the photo texture. And if I want to do an artificial light pass later and effects later, like sparks and light beams, I'll do that in the end, okay? So yeah, I think that's it. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Never mind, I actually found it. Okay, here I am painting the people and putting the light beams in. You know, I'm just like, Mega Man, he does like little beats. He's not Iron Man, he's a little bit different. Not really sure the right way to do it. But I figure, yeah, this will look good. Put in some smog and lighting, you know, more theatrical stuff, put in some lights and stuff all in separate layers. And yeah, it's done.
So hey guys, so right now we're at 7:40. I want to take the time to see if there's anything you guys want. Do you guys want to see a demo? Do you guys want to ask some questions? There's actually more lecture stuff, but I wanted to see what you guys are thinking right now.
I just have like a question. So after, how did you think like what you did at Carnegie like influenced you, especially when you were like taking other classes and stuff afterwards?
I think at Carnegie Mellon, right, it's a really smart school. So instead of just doing art, I'm like constantly questioning things. I'm learning about business. I'm learning about marketing. I started my own business, you know. I'm finding out how to, before it takes me 50 hours to do something, but I'm smart, right? So I read a bunch of books on like meta learning and like psychology and stuff. So I was like, okay, how do I make 50 hours into 5 hours? And, you know, maybe some artists do that, but I do think some of the left brain thinking, the really analytical side of me, helped give me an extra edge. It's like, you're artistic, right? That's good. And you're smart, that's good. What if you're smart and artistic? Damn, now what? You know? It's kind of, yeah. I mean, if you're only smart and not artistic, well, okay, these artistic people might have an edge on you. But it's like, okay, you went to these schools, I'm gonna take those classes too. And I went to Carnegie Mellon. Like, okay, now let's go. But being at Carnegie Mellon doesn't mean you don't have to work on your skill. You still, just because you're smart, you gotta be able to, you know, do stuff too. Any more questions? Yes?
So when you do a concept art for like a theme park,
yes,
where does that go after you give them the concept art? How does that kind of start the process of becoming realized?
That's a really good question. So typically what happens is I work for companies who are like design firms. So it's like they have to send, I basically help make PowerPoint files. They put the concept art in the PowerPoint and then they go to the client and they say like, this is it. Do you guys like it? And then if they do like it, then it goes into 3D model and SD phase, which is basically like a blueprint and stuff. And if they like everything, and then eventually when you do the entire design package, they get paid, because a lot of design companies, all they do is design. And a while later, then they build it. So yeah, I don't really have to worry about building so much. I was really surprised because I think on my third job, I was like, yo, dude, like, because you're interested in building, right?
Yeah.
I was like, yo, dude, this is like too big, you know? And like, oh, this can't be like this. And then my art director was all like, yo, it's okay. Just make it pretty. It's okay. Just make it the size of a house. And I'm like, are you sure? Like, yes, don't worry about realisticness at this point. And I was pretty surprised. But it was like, I was there to do my job. I was basically an artistic salesman. But as you can see with Booth, sometimes you do need the realistic stuff. When I was working on more like maybe a mall with buildings and they're doing resurfacing or something like that, more realistic, closer to getting built and stuff, then they're like, okay, do this line. Do I have any examples of line drawings? I guess it would be more, oops. This is kind of like interior design-y looking, and this is like, I thought of like a hotel room, maybe, but maybe this is closer to being realistic, where I'm like, okay, you would buy this here, you would buy this here, you would buy this as a thing, so it's really close to more realism, you know, a hotel room, that's really realistic. But, yeah. Does that answer your question? You want to know about the industry, right?
Kind of, and I was okay. Also... like kind of relating it to what I know through
okay.
Scenic design for theater.
Okay.
And like a lot of our work will start kind of conceptually, but then we have to very much think about how it fits in space,
yes.
How it moves and all that.
Yeah. I would say a lot of times they build a 3D model first. So they'll be like, okay, this is how much space you have. They give you the 3D drawing. Do you guys, okay, let me show you guys because people love seeing. Let's see. 3D model of a theater. They don't want you to draw too much, so they'd give you a 3D model that looks like this and say, you can draw in this square. You can't draw anything outside of it. And it's like, oh, okay, cool. And then they come back and be like, no, we can't do that. And then be like, okay, well, let's do this. Well, can we do this? And it's like, okay, we can do that. That's within our budget. But yeah. And in Booth, I had to build it myself, right? Like for design projects, like you draw something, you're gonna have to model that stuff. So it's really like, oh, I'm gonna make it pretty easy to build. So I don't have to do that much work later. But I guess I'm concerned. But for a lot of the professional work I've been doing, I didn't really have to build it. And you know what's really fun? I actually don't need to think about the creative side either, because the art director is the one doing that. So it's like, I just need to draw, and like he'd be like, here are your image boards. Here is your 3D model. Okay, take these image boards and put it on the 3D, you know, basically draw it on. And that was really surprising because there wasn't a lot of thinking involved, but it was really fast, you know? Because that's like the hard part, right? Like, but this guy who is, you know, has 20 years of experience, he's the one who's doing the high concept stuff. A lot of times, I think I was talking to a student about this, saying like, you know, the people at CMU were really high concept, right? But what I found in my experience is when I'm going to work, the people who do the high concept isn't the entry level, the new person. It's the creative art director who's been there for like 10 years. They get to do all that stuff. And we're kind of there to, you know, do what they tell us to. So, of course, you can have creative ideas sometimes. But after a while, maybe 5-10 years later, it'll be you who's the guy calling the shots. So yeah, professional experience, not academia. Anything else? Are you guys sad? Yes.
Was it like tough for you to like sort of figure out how to like get to this sort of point when like where a lot of the people at CMU were sort of focusing more on like industrial design, like traditional like graphic design, like interaction design kind of projects, and like it was sort of hard to figure out like I guess your friends aren't really doing this or were they?
No. I would say I definitely felt really left out. I felt like a strange. You know, I felt like no one got me. Emo, not really. Well, maybe I was a little emo. Hard to imagine, but yeah. And it was really frustrating because, like, my opinion didn't line up with what everyone else thought. And I guess I want to point that out to you guys. Maybe you're doing some design stuff and you think it's cool, but your professor thinks it sucks. Your peers thinks it sucks, you know? And everyone laughs at your work. And, you know, if that happens, you know, stick with your guns and keep doing it. I'd say I definitely...
What kind of direction did you have while you were a student here? Like, did you think in the 4 years here that you were going to be doing concept art, or at first were you influenced by the whole tech?
Oh, you know, we didn't have the whole... I heard you guys are learning programming and stuff now. HCI was just starting back then. I would say I wasn't influenced by that. I was supposed to learn 3D modeling, but I barely learned that either. I took a semester. I'm really anti-tech. I'm not really good at it. That's why I don't design video games and movies, because I like real life experiences like this. Was I influenced by it? Can you see your question again?
I guess,
just thinking.
What kind of career goals did you have while you were
None.
Here?
None.
Like, did you have a direction, or were you just like, oh, I'm gonna get my assignment done?
I just wanted to. I was thinking very short term. You know, I didn't start applying for jobs until like after college. It was just about building booths. Yeah. And I applied for theme park exhibit design jobs afterwards, and I didn't get them. But yeah, I didn't really think much. So yeah, you guys started thinking about long term. I think during that time, I just wanted to have fun and experience college life, build booths, dance. Yeah. Yes.
So like, when you were this is kind of like related to that.
Yes.
Also sort of thing. Okay. When you were like going into design, because it's like a pretty specialized program like, compared
uh-huh.
to a lot of like, chemistry or whatever.
Yes.
Did you have like, was what you found in the program and what your expectations were coming in, were they like, very different?
Yes. Very different.
Okay.
I thought it was going to be kind of like art center where you draw stuff a lot and you build stuff. But here it was, you know, like CMU stuff. I was making like acorns out of paper and I'm like, what is this? but yeah, I definitely learned it. Basically all my weaknesses it worked on being communicating really clearly. I think it's something I do learn, and sometimes it does come out and it definitely helps you, you know. I actually emailed a guy, a transportation designer, who went to CMU and he went to Art Center, and I'm like, what do you think? What should I do? And he said, I'll definitely recommend going to Art Center if you can get in, but I wouldn't be the person today if I didn't go to CMU. So yeah, I definitely don't regret going here. I came here for the interdisciplinary stuff. That was all over my college essays. Interdisciplinary, transdisciplinary, you know, that stuff. Because they advocated it. If I wanted a job straight, I would have went to Art Center. But I wanted the whole business, engineering, computer experience thing. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I got what I came for. Yes, sir.
I guess I'm curious, like, throughout all this sort of, you talked about, like, you can't just be good at straight foundations because that doesn't sort of get you a job, like, you're drawing foundations. But I guess I'm curious, like, out of all the sort of more traditional or foundational art work and studies that you did do, what do you find sort of, like, recurring in the work that you do now? Or what sort of, like, strikes you as the most important of your studies during that time?
That's a good question. Like composition, like I guess I can just reiterate a bunch of art principles, but it sounds kind of canned. Are you saying like which? Well, I'm good at color. I did a bunch of color stuff, right? Let me see. I want to give you like a good answer. Authentically passionate. What the? Oh, you know what's a good answer? Here. It's a lot of times in nowadays we take photos and put them in, right? But the thing is, it looks sterile. You know, the art director will be like, oh my god, like it looks like someone just took a photo and put it in there. Can you look at more, make it look more artistic? And because I did a bunch of these painting stuff, you know, I can like make it like stretch the arm, make the color, exaggerate the color, make it flow more, make it look like I painted it. And because I could paint it if I wanted to from scratch, I'm able to make the photo look like more paint. Do you want to see this? Oh, check this out, check this out. Chris Turner Star Wars. This is a Disney guy. Oh shoot. Christopher Turner. Star Wars Launch Bay. Okay, so check this out. So these are like photos, right? That this guy painted on top of. But it looks pretty like naturalistic. But this is what the guy can do. Let's see. Like this is how he normally draws, you know? Like, so he can take photos and make it look more expressive. And I kind of feel the same way. You know, I'm not as good as this guy, but I can also put in the photos, you know, and make it expressive. And I know like, you know, perspective. So, cause some people, they put in photos and it looks like really wonky because their perspective's not right. But if you know perspective, you can, yeah, do, so. Still have foundations, I'm not saying not to do them, but it's like do the minimum you can to get the job done. Like this is something I read in the book 4-Hour Workweek. So basically it's a principle, like if you were to boil water, water boils at how many degrees?
100
degrees Celsius, right? Right? If you turn the temperature to 120 degrees, does it burn different? Well, actually, according to the book, it doesn't really do anything more, but he's basically saying like, do what is necessary to get the job done, the most effective and efficient use of your effort, you know? You don't need to, like, if I'm like a fighter, like I don't need to be able to do maybe like 10,000 push-ups, that might be overkill. But if I can do like 1,000 push-ups, that might be good for me to win the fight against, you know, a boxer or something. Okay, not then. I say we have 5 minutes left. Thank you guys so much. Can I have a volunteer? Does anyone want to do the art job thing? Anyone?
I don't know what it is, but I'll volunteer for it.
Okay, can you come up here?
Sure.
Do you know, what's your major?
Design.
Design, do you have a dream job?
Not a specific position yet.
Okay, it's okay. What's like something you like or a company you'd like to work for?
Disney Imagineers.
Disney Imagineers.
Yes.
Okay, cool. That's kind of like what I want to do. Okay, Disney Imagineers. Disney Imagineering. Do you know how to get a job at Disney Imagineering?
Not quite, but I do know a lot of people from here do go there. Apparently there is a pact or a partnership going on.
Uh-huh. So, I would probably Google Walt Disney Imagineering. Well, this is kind of easy because they have a thing. And like, here, I'll just go internship. Co-ops, Disney professional internships. Okay, apply here. Internships, co-ops. Search jobs. Well, you can apply. And if you were to say, there's like a Disney Imagineering contest? Contest? Disney. If you've done research for a couple hours, it's like, oh, found this contest.
Actually,
enter the contest.
I'm just going to email it to everybody.
Yeah? I didn't know about this contest until I already graduated. And at that time, it was already too late to enter because you have to be a student. Or be a student of 6 months.
Yes. I think a year or two ago.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then almost every year, somebody can see
you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Enter the contest.
Okay. Yeah.
And another thing you can do, you can stalk people who worked at LinkedIn. So type in Imagineering. Oops, no. Disney Imagineering. Okay. Oh, okay. So then, like, a lot of people, you can start Googling these purple. Sorry, I know this guy, Jason. So let's say you find this guy, right? Like, oh, look at the, and start Googling his name. So that's too broad. So it's LinkedIn profile. Oh, let's go to, sorry, man. So it's like his Twitter, you know, you can do your research on this guy. See his portfolio. Oh, he has a website. Cool. Do you get the gist? Go to his website. This is what his work looks like. Can you send him an email saying like, oh, hey, you know, love your work. That's really cool. I have a question. How do I apply for an internship? What are you guys looking for? Is there any, yeah.
Okay,
bam, bam, bam.
I also heard from people sometimes it's hard when they ask to connect with even alumni in LinkedIn.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes the alumni don't respond.
Yes.
But then you can look them up in the alumni database, which all
uh-huh.
students have access to.
Yes.
You can just register for that, and then you can email them directly, which is
uh-huh.
really nice.
That too. Yeah. Personally, for some, I never relied on alumni though, for some reason, because I think my second job, I went in the first day, right? And I finally got the job, and I was like, hey, I know you all went to CMU. And then I knew like three people from CMU. And I was like, oh shoot, like this Carnegie Mellon thing is, I don't know, maybe we're not that strong in that area. Well, it's people, right? I don't know. So I find this way, because Sanjula did the alumni thing with me, but I thought it had, the results I got were okay. I felt like I had more tactile results when I emailed people who are already putting themselves out there. Because this guy, he's already doing Twitter, and he already wants advertising, telling people to contact him, right? But do that too, yes.
What do you mean by the alumni thing?
You can contact CMU alumni, I think.
Okay.
But yeah, sometimes it's so it worked really well post stalking LinkedIn stage, because that's all you had.
Yeah.
That's all you had, the alumni database. But now you have this thing called the internet and Twitter, Instagram, whatever, and LinkedIn. You can get not just CMU alumni, but everyone who works at the company. So before it was pretty valuable, but now you have an even more crazy resource, LinkedIn. It's really powerful. You can even pay $100, and then I think you have like LinkedIn Premium, and you can even like message people who aren't connected to you. Do you want to see it?
Yeah.
The LinkedIn Premium?
Yeah. I mean, I have a LinkedIn. I'm just like, what do I do with LinkedIn? Mm-hmm. Do I pay the $100?
Let's say, what's the name of the different company?
DreamWorks.
DreamWorks, okay. I know some people from DreamWorks. Let's find someone who I don't know. Okay, so I don't know this guy, but let's say I wanted to, no, he's a second connection, so that's too easy. I can still connect with him. Shoot. Oh, what's a more obscure company that I don't have any friends in?
Blue Sky,
yeah, I don't have any friends in Blue Sky, I think. Second. Oh, I know too many people. Okay, let's look up LinkedIn Premium. Oh, try Premium for free, okay. You can try Premium for free, email all the people, and then deactivate it. So, say, grow in this. So there's advanced search, unlimited profile search. You can view unlimited profile from search results up to third degree. Oh, so that's why I can't find it. So basically, I can find someone. Thanks for coming, guys. Thank you guys
so
much.
Thank
you. If their portfolio or resume is on their LinkedIn profile, you can see it. So this allows you to see anyone you want, almost anyone. Yeah? Okay. So yeah, it's about 8 o'clock. So I want to thank you guys so much for coming. Yeah, hope to help. I know you guys are super busy, so good luck with everything. Last tip, exercise. Exercise is good for your brain. As you guys are leaving, I want to show you guys this book. It's called Spark. Basically, recommend reading the book. It shows you become smarter by doing exercise. 4-hour week work week, time management. It's like it totally hacks time management, you know, managing your time. Money, study money. Money is different from hard work. Study money as well. This is another money book. What else? And dude, you can make so much money doing art. Check out this person, inspiration. You know what this is? This is Patreon. This person makes $60,000 in a month. That's 60 times 12, 7,200. 180,000. So, yeah. 700, that's like six figures. And this is what she does. This is what she draws. And she has so many fans. So it's just like, I want to say it's possible, but she's also doing, she has great marketing, great business savvy, you know, and stuff like that. So, yeah, I just wanted to inspire you guys a little bit. Because like, you would think, like, illustrator, you can't make money doing, this person makes 60. And she's like our age. Like, I think she's like 20-something. Yeah, this is $50,000 per month, not per year, per month. Drawing anime. Yeah. Anything's possible, guys.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks for coming.